In the game Count to 18, players take turns counting either one or two numbers. The first one to get to 18 wins.
Do you want to start or should I start?
I'll start. Okay. 1, 2.
3, 4.
5, 6.
7.
8, 9.
10, 11.
12, 13.
14.
15, 16.
17, 18.
It's a fairly simple game that you can play at any time. You should try it out on your own to see if you can figure out the winning strategy. Seriously, pause the video now and try it out before I spoil it for you. The trick to winning is to make sure you end each turn on a multiple of 3. It turns out that the second player has an advantage because they can always force the count to a multiple of 3. Whenever the first player counts one number, the second player counts 2, and vice versa.
Okay, I'll start. 1, 2. 3. 4.
5, 6.
7, 8.
9.
10, 11.
12.
13.
14, 15.
16.
17, 18.
Not even Math Dad can beat this strategy. We could stop here and we'd have a short, entertaining game that you could consistently win. But we're going to take things a little further and look at some possible variations on this game, and you might discover that it's even more fun to analyze the variations than it is to play the game itself. Count to 18 is an example of a subtractive game, because it's sometimes played with 18 items that are taken by players who alternate turns claiming either one or two of the items. Whoever takes the last item wins. Here's a slight variation on our Count to 18 game, where each player can count by 1, 2, or 3. What's the best strategy? And which player has the advantage? You should pause the video and try it on your own before continuing. Instead of just telling you the answer, I'm going to show you how you can figure it out on your own by analyzing backwards from the end. Backtracking is a useful strategy when it comes to analyzing games. I like to think of it as more of a game board where two players take turns moving a token. The winner is the one who moves the token to the final square. I've added in a zero square as a starting point, and I'll mark the final square with a blue dot. I'll place red X's in each square that can reach the blue dot. You know you can win if you are at 15, 16, or 17, since we can count 1, 2, or 3 numbers. So if a player starts on 14, then they have to move to a square with a red X, so we'll mark 14 with a blue dot. We'll continue on labeling squares with a red X if they can reach a blue dot, and squares get a blue dot label if they must move to a red X. 11, 12, and 13 can get to 14, so they get a red X. 10, we have to move to a red X. 7, 8, and 9 can all reach a blue dot. 6 must move to a red X. 3, 4, and 5 can each reach a blue dot at 6, so they get red X's. And the 2 gets a blue dot, and that means 0 and 1 get a red X. So, what is our conclusion? Well, from each red X square, we can always move to a blue dot square. And from each blue dot, must move to a red X. That means that the first player can win by always jumping to a blue dot. The first player has a winning strategy. There are lots of other subtractive games that we could create. I just chose 18 because it would conveniently fit on the screen. We could count to 50 by 1s, 2s, 3s, 4s, or 5s. And in that case, we could ask which player would win. You should be able to figure it out now. There's no limit to the variations we could make. Let's try analyzing a harder version of the Count to 18 game, where you count by 1s, 3s, or 4s. We'll also add the rule that you have to land on exactly 18. You can't skip over it. As before, we put a blue dot on 18. The squares that can reach 18 in one turn are 14, 15, and 17. From 16, we can only move to 17. From 12 and 13, we can get to 16, so those get a red X. At 11, we have to move to a red X, so 11 gets a blue dot. From 7, 8, and 10, we can reach 11. From 9, we have to move to an X. We can reach 9 from 5 and 6, so they get X's. From 4, we have to move to an X. And from 0, 1, and 3, we can reach 4. While from 2, we would have to move to an X. So the final conclusion is that the first player wins. Once again, the strategy is always to move from an X to a dot. Now let's get a bit crazy and say that we can count by negative 1, 2, or 5. That means that we could count backwards 1 if we want. From 13 and 16, we can reach 18, so they get an X. From 14, we have to reach 13 or 16, so 14 gets a dot. And 17 also gets a dot because it can only reach an X. Now 9, 12, and 15, we can reach a 14, so they get an X. From 10, we can only reach X's. 5, 8, and 11 are squares where we can reach a dot. 6 gets a dot because it can only reach an x. 1, 4, and 7 get x's because they can all reach 6. From 2, we can only get to x's, so 2 gets a dot. And finally, we can reach a dot from both 0 and 3, so they get x's. Yet again, it looks like the first player can always win this variation of Count to 18 by always counting to a square with a blue dot. Sometimes the game could end in a draw. For example, if we only allow counting by 2s, 3s, or 4s, then we might get stuck on 17. If it was your turn and you were on a number without a dot or an x, then you'd want to count your way to another blank square. Avoid the red squares at all costs. In some variations, where you allow negative numbers, the game would never end because neither player would be willing to count past a certain point. A smart player would keep the count below 12 in this variation. It's a lot of fun to make up your own variations and then try to figure out which player has the advantage. You can choose different numbers to count by, or you can count to something other than 18. You could even try a game with more than two players. I'll leave you with one final challenge. Which player will win this Count to 18 game if you are only allowed to count by 1s, 2s, 4s, or 6s? Leave your answer in the comments and let us know if you come up with any variations that are particularly fun.